Honestly, who doesn't love a good war now and then? You know, there's so much fun to be had. There's guns, there's explosions, there's countless losses of lives that could have been avoided, and possible war crimes and mass graves. But today, I would like to talk to you guys about a particular game that I whittled away hundreds of hours to, literally hundreds of hours to, on a little handheld game that rivaled Pokemon and Fire Emblem back in the day in the 90s and early 2000s, had plenty of sequels, was really well regarded by the gaming community, and still, for some reason, we haven't seen a new edition of. And that game is Advance Wars. Developed by Intelligent Systems and released in Europe January 11th, 2002, this franchise was an instant and unstoppable success for the Game Boy Advance. In fact, all the reviews at the time, and even now, show beaming scores of 92 on Metacritic, 10 out of 10 from Eurogamer. Game Ranking even rates this game as the highest rated game ever to be released on the Game Boy Advance.
Take that, Pokemon, you piece of shit!
Oh, and if Intelligent Systems sounds familiar to you guys, they also worked on the Fire Emblem, Super Metroid, WarioWare, and Paper Mario franchises, so... yeah, those guys. This series is technically still ongoing, with the last edition to the series being released in 2008, however, today I'll actually be talking about the original Advance Wars, and hopefully talk about its sequels in some future videos. Advance Wars is set in Cosmoland, in a... Wars world. Wars world? You know, your civilization has been through some rough times when its single defining feature is global annihilation and conflict. Four nations, Orange Star, Blue Moon, Yellow Comet, and Green Earth, are in turmoil, with you playing as the Orange Star Army in the midst of the conflict and tension caused by an unknown force, with you squarely in the crosshairs of every rival nation. In simple terms, it's a turn-based strategy game wherein two or more armies fight on gridded maps for one of two objectives. Destroy the opponent's army, or capture the enemy headquarters. To do this, you coordinate and command armies of varying sizes at your disposal in the form of cute, brightly coloured little sprites of infantry, tanks, jeeps, artillery, rockets, APCs, anti-air guns, battleships, submarines, carriers, landers, bombers, battlecopters, fighters.
Now listen here, men. You're gonna go back out there, and you're gonna fight. And you may die, but you will hold the line. Or you will win this war. Do you hear me, Private? Do you hear me?
Initially, you start with tutorial-styled levels that provide you with a small battalion of units to complete each mission. Don't know how to play? Well, Commander of the Orange Star Army, Nell, teaches you the basics in your first couple of fights. And the great thing is, it's one of those learn-it-by-doing-it deals where you'll be told exactly where to place your units and see the effect of using them. After the first few missions, you then obtain the ability to pick and choose the units you want to deploy from factories, airports, and harbors. Each has their own strengths, weaknesses, and quirks with other units, but the main draw is that more powerful units cost more money to build. This is great because, depending on your situation, different groupings of cheaper and more expensive units will drastically change your tactics. So for example, if you have 8,000 in cash and are under attack by infantry, you may want to buy one anti-aircraft gunner to make short work of them, but be limited to attacking once per turn. Or instead, you could make two recon units to still deal superior damage at the expense of actions, or even 8 infantry in order to make use of the terrain defenses and give you more alternatives in battle formations. Plus, as the units always start with 10 HP, as they get more whittled down and beaten up, they deal less damage and the game becomes more complex as battles wage on. Therefore, depending on your unit preferences, CO choice, terrain layout, or victory parameters, each mission illustrates how best to utilize your cash in the best manner. Each turn you earn cash depending on the amount of structures you own, so for each city you have, you earn 1,000 cash, i.e. enough to buy one infantry. Using your infantry, you can capture more buildings to earn more cash, but infantry on their own are the weakest units in the game and have rubbish mobility to get across the map. This beautifully crafted system encourages you to use transport vehicles, convoys, and support units to clear paths and protect your units as you strategically take control of factories with which to build your own units across the map and even overthrow enemy cities to appropriate their cash flow. However, on the subject of strategy, this game also features a host of commanding officers known as COs, each with their own distinct unit attributes and powers. For example, when you start the game, you play as Andy, a mechanic whose units have no particular strengths or weaknesses, and is the vanilla CO. However, his power allows you to heal all units in your army for 2 points of damage. Another early CO, Max, specializes in brute force units such as tanks and has a firepower bonus for said units. His power also makes his direct units ridiculously strong for one turn and as such is great for shock tactics. However, Max is crap at using indirect combat units such as battleships, artillery and rockets, and has not only reduced firepower, but also reduced range when using them. Meaning, if you get into a battle zone with tough terrain and mountains leading to snake-like paths of single-fire ground units, Max can easily be at a disadvantage. This is the true beauty of this series, as each time you play you have to think about how you can use a CO's abilities to best effect, and how to make up for their shortcomings. The game even pits you against polar opposite enemies to show you just how varied and diverse the battles can be. For example, in the Blue Moon campaign, Max routinely fights the CO, Grit, who is a specialist in indirect combat, usually in maps of Fog of War, where Max will be tasked with cautiously advancing to Grit's HQ without being picked off by sneakily hidden units in fortified spots. And the thing is, Advance Wars has some really distinct, memorable and likeable characters, such as Sammy the infantry specialist, Drake the good-hearted pirate, Max the meathead, Eagle the pilot, Honorable Emperor Kanbei, or even Sturm, the all-powerful alien warmonger thing. And each has their own motivations, quirks, and theme music to distinguish between them.
And speaking of the music, it's pretty simple, but I gotta say, it's catchy. Does the job, and it's fantastic.
Due to the gameplay aspect of most turns lasting anywhere from 20 seconds to a few minutes, the music has to be unobtrusive yet catchy, memorable yet simple. So whether you're listening to Olaf's Russian-themed aesthetic, Grit's Country Amble, Kanbei's Asian Fanfare, or Drake's Sea Shanty. It's easy to draw real-life correlations to each faction and character. And to unlock characters every time you finish a mission, you earn war funds, which scale up depending on the rank you get. And to obtain better ranks, you're graded on speed of victory achieved, the amount of units destroyed in your most destructive turn, and how many units you keep intact. These funds are used at the menu shop called Battle Maps to purchase unlocked COs and additional challenge maps with additional battles to test your skills on. The challenge maps serve to hone your skills in a less friendly environment. No help is given to you as far as advice goes, and all the maps give more resources to your opponent to start with, and each one can be tackled with any of the COs you've unlocked while playing the campaign and unlocked in the shop. Plus, some of the later ones pit you against two COs at once. Which, you know, is, fair. And if that wasn't enough for you, there's even a level creator. I remember fondly making maps at home, going to school, and the next day playing them against my friends in the playground. And I promise, for the most part, the maps were more creative than this one. Plus, if you play through the campaign once, you can also unlock the advanced campaign, which is exactly the same campaign with the same enemies and COs to use. However, enemy COs get much more powerful units added to the mix, making each mission incredibly more difficult to beat. However, you will get double coins for completing them, and will rank up a lot faster. And I must admit, I did pretty well. Look at that, all S ranks!
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again. Because a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping. And the vision that was planted in my brain still remains within the sound.
So there we have the original Advance Wars. The sequels, in my opinion, were better, and I have not tried some of the other games like Battalion Wars for the GameCube or Famicom Wars for the original Famicom, and then there was even games on the Super Famicom before this game. I haven't tried those games out, but for me, The sequels were better, and maybe one day I'll cover them, but I would still suggest going out and trying this game out on whatever you can find it on. Maybe you get the original copy for the Game Boy Advance, maybe you try out the Virtual Console version on the Wii U, but also I believe you can play this on the PC somehow. I've definitely seen people playing it. I don't know if it's a ROM or if it's on a server similar to Steam, but it's definitely on PC in some nook of the internet as well. So my advice, go check it out. You won't regret it. Don't worry, I'll wait. I'll keep Private Jones here company. We'll wait. Sound off, 1, 2. Sound off, 3, 4. Sound off, 1, 2. Hey guys, thanks so much for watching this video. I hope you guys enjoyed it. This video was actually only made across about 3 days of work. I got Capture, then I scripted it and did a chunk of the editing, and then today I finished off the editing and I did the live action. So I'm really interested to see what you guys say about the overall quality of the video. I want to hear from you guys if you like how the video is a bit less long form. It's about 10 minutes rather than 20 with my last upload, and how you guys feel about the quality of it despite it being, I suppose, more focused towards the meat of the context of the video. And I really want to hear from you guys how you enjoyed this video, or if you didn't think it was enough time to get into the subject, or if it was a bit subpar from my usual stuff. So let me know in the comments. Also, I will be doing a new sort, well, I will be doing a themed month tomorrow, which is kind of the reason I wanted to get this video done over a couple of days, and I've actually booked a couple of days off to get it done. And so yeah, there should be a really cool amount of content coming up this next month. There should be a list video, a gem, a gauntlet, possibly a VGO, possibly a gaming survival guide. I'll see how it goes. Again, it's all about how much time I actually have. And I am going to be taking some time off this week, but not for videos, for another project I'm working on outside of YouTube. So hopefully I will have a lot of time to make the videos for this upcoming month, and they'll be really good. But we'll have to see how everything pans out. But the main point I wanted to let you know about is, please let me know what you thought of this video in particular, because it is drastically different in its production than a lot of the ones I've done in the past. But other than that, enjoy the little kind of tidbits after this bit here, kind of deleted scenes, bonus material, bloopers. And other than that, thanks so much for watching this video, and I will see you guys later.
Don't test my patience, Private.
Come on, you. Celebrate.
Yeah.
I don't know, but I've been told. Eskimo pussy is mighty cold.
It's a water gun. Water pistol. It's not a real one, but you can see the, see this is where the screws go.